There is a way that seems right to a person, but if that way is not pleasing in the sight of our Lord, it will end in death. Even while laughing, a heart can ache, and joy can end in grief, because a heart that turns from God becomes bored with his own ways. But a good person is satisfied with God's ways. Will you please turn to our screen as we sing our first hymn this morning, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Remember that this is Communion Sunday. With me. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be here this morning to worship you with our song and our words, our prayers and our thoughts. You are the one true God, Yahweh, Alpha and Omega, the Holy One among us. In the beginning, you showed great love for us, your creation, and all you asked in return was for us to love you back, to worship and obey you, and no other. You have gone through much with us, your creation. We have not always been the people of your dreams and heart's desires, but you have always been here to be our God and our salvation. Help us to be worthy, to Teach us to be the people you desire us to be. Fill us with love for one another. Put a desire in our hearts to please you and to spread the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ. One day he will come again to reclaim all that is his. He will sit upon his throne as the King of Kings, and we will be on his right as the bride of Christ. Help us to be pure and worthy. Open our hearts and our minds so that we may be worthy and understand more. Fill this place in our hearts with the Holy Spirit and sanctify us. For it's in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. You may be seated as we go back to our screen for Blessed Assurance. Please turn with me to the screen as we do our responsive reading from Psalms 22. I will tell my people about your name.
I will praise you within the congregation.
All who fear the Lord, praise him.
All ye nations, glorify his name.
Amen. Our next hymn this morning is our praise hymn from Amazing Love. And as I said, as we get ready to get communion, I want you to go in prayer while we sing and make yourself ready for that as well. Clear any sin or anything that stands away from between you and the Lord.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and world. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my king, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do, to honor you. I'm forgiven because you are forsaken. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my king, should die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. To honor you in all I do.
It's the first Sunday, and we're in 2019 already, but it's the first Sunday in January. So what do we get? What's our prize for the new Sunday?
A new memory verse.
Oh, a new memory verse, yes. Then said Jesus, if you continue in my word, this is from John 8:31. Then said Jesus, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed.
Then said Jesus, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. John 8:31.
Amen. You guys ought to be able to learn that one pretty quick, huh? Jacob? Yeah? All right. Good boy. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
All right, that's a little bit better. I thought maybe you guys were sleeping, but you're not. All right, and good morning to all of you that are watching from home as well. as we get ready for communion this morning. I hope that you're taking the time to clear the way between you and God, and that you can join us this morning for communion. We also, I haven't announced it for a while, but we do have sets that we can send you. If you want to take communion with us, just give us a call at the number, the 967 number. Let me know that you want to take communion with us, and we're there. And again, if you're a person that watches this show regularly and you don't have a pastor, you're a shut-in, and you would like for me to come by and give you communion personally, and pray with you, give me a call at that number, 967-3628, and we'll get together. If you need counseling, please give us a call here at that same number, and we'll see about getting you in for some counseling. You know, we don't charge for counseling, and I've got an extensive background in counseling. You're probably not going to find anybody around here that's as competent and capable. So you can get some really good counseling here at the church. Bible study, we'll try to get in Tuesday, 6:30. We'll have our Bible studies. I was pleased that the school called me on Thursday, but I had already given them a note. But somebody had forgotten, I guess, that it's going to be this week that we'll start our Wednesday program and our Thursday program. This Wednesday, we have the sign lady coming in. We just bought some canvases, made a good deal on some canvases, so we'll be ready next week when the paint lady comes. We bought another keyboard so that we think we have somebody that may come in once a month to teach music lessons here, and so we're really looking forward to that. I do need some help. I've got a couple people that watch us from the TV that help us by sending money in to help with the kids' programming. And certainly all of that stuff I just mentioned, if it wasn't for the donations, the tithe, the offering, the offerings of love that we receive from you, the few, because we don't receive a lot of money off the TV, because we don't really spend a lot of time asking for money off the TV, But we're always able to be here to take your tithe. And if you want to help us continue to work with these programs, I'm looking for somebody that I need to help me work with getting the kids in this. And I'm still looking for another person to come in for the fourth Sunday, our fourth Wednesday a week, and try to turn a bunch of kids into, give them some voice lessons. And now that I've got a couple of kids that know how to read music and they're pretty sharp. You've heard them, and we're gonna continue to try to channel a lot of that energy that these kids have into something productive. Potluck next Sunday. Remember that. Jacob, what's next Sunday?
Potluck
next Sunday. Yeah, we're going to have a great time. And if you want to send our program to someone else, or you want to tell somebody else to get it, you can go to YouTube and just type my name, Rudolph Babcock. I don't think you need the Reverend or the Doctor or anything else in it, just Rudolph Babcock. You can also go to Facebook. You can go to the stream. There's lots of ways to pick up our program here, and we look forward to hearing people, hearing from you if you like the program, and I even take people's comments that I think I've said this several times before, years in the past. One of the person when I was at a church before, the person that I had the most communication with in a telephone conversations with was somebody that didn't hardly agree with me at all, but we had a lot of good discussions. But I think it's kind of hard to. I think most people that are watching like our program, because I teach straight from the Bible. All right. This morning, do we have praise and prayer requests? God working miracles and wonderful things in your lives. And before, since I'm looking at you, before you answer the sixth graders are going to have the opportunity to switch over to the teen program on Wednesday, so you'll have to get a note from your mom to get off the bus to get onto the bus over at the high school if you want to switch over on Wednesday. And you know, then it's time to grow up. We're growing everybody up. All right, praises. Yes.
My grandma's out of the hospital.
All right, praise the Lord. That's good. And it's good for you that you think about other people and you want prayer for them as well, and to thank God for their recovery. Yes. Aunt who?
My uncle.
Pray for your uncle.
My aunt and my uncle are feeling well, so I want...
Okay, your aunt and uncle. All right, very good, Antonio. Anyone else this morning have a praise or prayer request? Yes.
I pray that my brother and my cousin will have a very, very good day.
Will what?
They'll have a good day.
Okay, good. Anyone else this morning? Yes.
Pray for Janet. She doesn't feel sick.
Oh, Janet. Yes, Janet is... Janet. Okay, good. Janet's sick, yes.
Well, I think we'll add into that your shoulder and Linda's knees and Jean and Brian's not feeling well. And so we'll just add everybody into that, that everybody gets feeling better.
Yes. Yeah, I spent all week fighting with the VA, and I think I finally got to move forward with that. So on my shoulder, but.
And I was just reminded that for Rita and Dale was Rita did post on Facebook that Dale was at the hospital for something this week that he wasn't feeling well.
Yeah, for his back. Yeah, I talked with them this week, and so.
And I would like to offer up in prayer my co-worker's brother Nathan, who was sent overseas with the military.
He went back overseas?
Yes.
All right. Anyone else this morning?
Praise the Lord that he takes care of me.
Praise the Lord, yes. Uh-huh. Amen. Yes. Yeah. My mother called yesterday and said, I'm not feeling good. I don't think I'm going to come. And I'm saying, Mom, I'm right in the middle of my sermon. Call me back later. She called me back later and said, well, I'm feeling better now, so I'll go to her. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Remember, use this time to clear anything that stands between you and the Lord. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, now's the time to ask God to remove that. And you know, those things that stand in the way of you receiving the blessing that you need to receive as we get ready for communion this morning. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for our church, and we thank you for our church family. We thank you for all of our kids and their parents, and Lord, we just ask you to continue to help us to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout this community. Help us be the people that we need to be. We ask you, Lord, to be with the all of the requests that we've made. With Janet is ill. We have several people that are ill or not feeling better or not feeling well and need to feel better. We have people that are have problems. I've got a problem with my shoulder, Gene and his kidneys, and other problems, the heart. So we, Lord, just ask you, Antonio's aunt and uncle. We have several people that are going through this period where they're not feeling well. We just ask you to put your hand upon all of them and return them back to health. We ask you to be with Dale, who went into the hospital with his back this week, and continue to watch over him. And Lord, we ask you to be with Nathan as he heads back overseas. We ask you to continue to be with all of our children who are here. Help them to grow up in a way that's pleasing to you. We ask you to put teachers and leaders in front of them that will give them the right words and the good advice and guide and lead them in a proper way now that they are back in school again. Lord, we just thank, be with all of our children's parents and watch over them as well. Lord, we ask you to be with this country, and we ask you to help us to continue to go along the right route. And we ask you to be with all of those who serve in our military and our firemen and policemen and all of those who serve us. Just be with them and be with their families as well. We ask all of these things in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? At the cross, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done, he groaned upon the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
That's not it. Okay.
Will my the sun in darkness hide and shut his glory in, when Christ the mighty Maker died for man the creature's sin?
This is always such a wonderful privilege to be able to be here and offer communion to you. Jesus sat at the table and he died. Just a few days ago, we were singing songs about his birth. And it won't be long before we come to Easter. But Jesus came as the baby to die for us. We're going to talk about one of the milestones, the stepping stone in Jesus' life in a minute. But he came. He came here because he loved you. He came here for you, not for himself. He came to bring us salvation. He sat at the table with his disciples just before going to the cross, knowing that he was going to go to the cross, knowing he was going to be betrayed by Judas. And yet, he sat there, he broke the bread, knowing that that was representing his body being broken for us. He prayed and then passed it to his disciples. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that our name is written on his heart and it cannot be erased. We thank you for His steadfastness, his perfection, and his desire. We ask you to be with him as he prepares our place and sits beside you. Watch over our great Lord. Living, he loved me. And dying, he saved me. This is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Jesus then took the cup. Every time I do this, I have to look in the cup. It's not possible to take the cup and not look into it, knowing that it represents the blood that was shed for the remission of our sins, so that our sins could be forgiven, so that our name could be written in the Lamb's Book of Life, so that Jesus could go to heaven and begin to build a place for you and I. He took the cup. And Lord, we just ask you to continue to bless us and watch over us. Father, we ask you to be with us. We know that one day soon, our Lord will return. And we pray that that day will be soon. As we can see all the signs around us that that day should be coming soon. It's in Jesus' name that we pray and that we ask. Amen.
Amen.
This is the blood that was shed for us. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me in the New Testament, Matthew 3, 13 through 17. Matthew 3, 13 through 17. Then Jesus appeared. He came from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. But John tried to stop him and said, "I need to baptize you. Why are you coming to me?" And Jesus answered him, "This is the way it has to be now. This is the proper way to do everything that God requires of us." Then John gave in to him. After Jesus was baptized, he immediately came up from the water. Suddenly the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God coming down as a dove to him. Then a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love, my Son, with whom I am well pleased. The title of my sermon this morning is Identified with Him Forever. Now, all of a sudden, John the Baptist walks out on the pages of Scripture. If we had Matthew's gospel only, we would ask, where did he come from? And what is his background? Because Matthew gives us none of that. And the reason is obvious. The prophet Malachi had said that the messenger would come ahead to prepare the way of for the coming of the king. Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. This messenger was John the Baptist. You don't really need to know anything about the background of a messenger because you are interested mostly in the message. The message is all important, and that is what you want. I always bring this characteristic up when I discuss Islam. Muhammad clearly states that he was a messenger. If he had been a messenger from God, he would have given his message and disappeared from the scene. But Muhammad made himself more important than the message. This is the key to the fakery of that so-called religion. There were many kings of Israel who hated the prophets and messengers sent to them by God. A lot of them were killed because of the message they carried. I know of no incidents and no prophet or judge or messenger in the Bible who made himself more important or even equivalent to the message he was sent to deliver. John the Baptist made it very clear that he was just the messenger. And Matthew is making that clear as well. Therefore, he walks out onto the pages of Scripture, preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now let's deal with these expressions and discover what they are actually meant to tell us. Number one, we'll look at repent ye. The kingdom of heaven is number two, and three is at hand. What do these very important things mean? Well, repent or repent ye is an expression that always has been given to God's people as a challenge to turn around. Repent in the original Greek is metanoia, meaning to change your mind. You are going in one direction, turn around and go in another. Repentance is primarily, I think, for saved people. That is for God's people in any age. They are the ones who, when they become cold and indifferent, are to turn. Remember, God is always protecting and gathering a remnant. And repentance is the message given to the seven churches of Asia Minor as well in Revelation 2 and 3. And it was the message of the Lord Jesus himself. Someone may ask whether the unsaved man is supposed to repent. But I tell you, the unsaved man is told that he is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the message of Paul to the jailer in Philippi. You can find that in Acts 16. When an unsaved person believes in Jesus, he is repenting. Faith means to turn to Christ. And when you turn to Christ, you must also turn from something. If you don't turn from something, then you aren't really turning to Christ. This is one of my big problems with the new modern church. That church we call the seeker-friendly church. They are looking for numbers and collection plates being filled, and they are not in the business of doing anything that may scare or chase people away. So they don't step on anyone's toes. In this seeker-friendly environment and seeker-friendly church, God is pure love. God is love. So just dive in and fill your pockets with all you can carry. That way you can take God into whatever sewer you dive into when you leave Sunday service. Repentance is really a part of believing. But the primary message that should be given to the lost today is that they should believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and then turn from their sinful ways. If you really turn to Christ, you are turning from something else. The expression kingdom of heaven means the rule of the heavens over the earth. The Lord Jesus is king. You can't have a kingdom without a king. Neither can you have a king without a kingdom. Richard III said in Act 5, Scene 4 of the Shakespearean play by that name, "My kingdom for a horse." If he had traded his kingdom for a horse, he wouldn't have been a king any longer. He would have only been a man on horseback. So a king must have a kingdom. So what did John the Baptist mean by the kingdom of heaven is at hand? He meant that the kingdom of heaven is present in the person of the king. In our world today, they're right here, right now, around us here in western Pennsylvania, eastern Ohio, is there a present reality of the kingdom of heaven? And the answer to that is yes, there is. Those who come to Christ as Savior and acknowledge Him as Lord are translated already into the kingdom of God's dear Son. They belong to Him now. And they have a much more intimate relationship than that of a subject with a king. Christ is the bridegroom, and believers are part of His bride. Then someone may ask whether we are like subjects in a kingdom because we are to carry out His commands. But again, I say, there is more to it than that. We are to obey Him because we love Him. It is a love relationship. John tells us, if ye love me, keep my commandments, Jesus says. The kingdom of heaven is the rule of the heavens over the earth. That's not in existence today. Christ is not reigning over the world today. There is something wrong with the thinking of those who insist that the kingdom of heaven is in existence in our day. Christ is not reigning in any form, shape, or fashion, except in the hearts of those who has received Him as Lord and Savior. He is someday coming to establish His kingdom on the earth. When He does, He will put down rebellion. Believe me, that will not be a pretty sight when He does. Rebellion is those people that have rebelled against Him, have not asked Him to be their Lord and Savior. They are in rebellion, and He's going to come to put down that rebellion. It is so important about this concept that is given to us twice in the Bible, once in Luke and the second time in Revelation. So listen, then shall they begin to say to the mountains, fall on us, and to the hills, cover us. When He comes to put down the rebellion, people are going to make these statements. It's going to be not a wonderful time. From Revelation we read, "And the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of Him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb." See, I don't want to be those people. I want to be the people that's written on His heart. I want to be the ones standing next to Him. I don't want to be the ones crying out for the rocks to fall on me. Is at hand. The kingdom of heaven was at hand or was present in the person of the king. That was the only way in which it was present. Matthew now tells us that what he is recording is in fulfillment of prophecy. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make His path straight." The prophet Isaiah is Isaiah, and the prophecy is in Isaiah 40 verse 3. Written 700 years earlier. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, all that John the Baptist claimed for himself was that he was a voice crying in the wilderness. And his purpose was to prepare the way of the Lord. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. This is remarkable. And we are going to try to answer, why was Jesus baptized? There may be several answers, but the primary reason is stated right here in verse 15. The translation from the King James says it, I think, the best. "For thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness," Jesus says. Jesus is identifying himself completely with sinful mankind. Now listen to me. This is why he was baptized, and it's important for us to know that he came to be baptized because he was identifying himself completely with sinful mankind. Isaiah had prophesied 700 years earlier that the Messiah would be numbered with the transgressions. You can find that in Isaiah 53:12. Here is a king who identifies himself with his subjects. Actually, baptism means identification. And I believe identification was the primary purpose for the baptism of the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, the reason Jesus was baptized was not to set an example for us. It was not a pattern for us to follow. And it wasn't the first or only step in salvation. The Jews baptized non-Jews into Judaism. It was the last of several steps. It signified a purification process and also a membership or identification. After baptism, a non-Jew could say he was a Jew. Usually this was done for the purposes of conducting business. And he could now do business directly with the Jews. For all the world to see, including the Jews, this person was a Jew, just as if he had been born by Jewish parents. The Essenes were out in the desert, and they were a Jewish group like the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They lived out in the desert. They also used baptism in the same way. The baptism was the legal document of adoption, identification, and belonging. They did purification baths and the baptism into the order of the Essenes. We derive our current laws of adoption from this process. A person or child who has been adopted has had his or her ties to the former family, even his or her parents, completely severed, as if they had never existed in the first place. The child is even given his parents' last name as their own forever. Christ was holy. He did not need to repent. You and I, we do need to repent. But he was holy, harmless, undefiled, and separate from sinners. He was baptized to completely identify himself with humanity. There was a second reason Jesus was baptized. Water baptism is symbolic of death. His death was a baptism. You remember that he said to James and John when they wanted to be seated on his right hand and on his left hand in the kingdom of heaven that was to come, and they wanted that part, and Jesus says to them, "You know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" He's talking about his death on the cross. You see, Christ's death was a baptism. He entered into death for you and for me. There is a third reason for the baptism of Jesus. At this time, he was set aside for the office of priest. The Holy Spirit came upon him for this priestly ministry. Before then, all the kings had been kings. But at this time, Jesus becomes the first king who is all three, prophet, priest, and king. Jesus Christ is not only Lord of Lords and King of Kings, but he is also our great high priest. He is the one who intercedes on our behalf before the Father. He is the only one who can intercede on our behalf. Satan thought he was going to have something to say in this process, but any part Satan might have had was taken from him when Jesus died and was raised again. In the Old Testament days, it was the high priest who went into the temple, into the most holy room, the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant resided and interceded for the people. We no longer have such a high priest who is a man, or high priest. Our high priest became Jesus Christ, and he is not just merely a man. Everything that Jesus did, his very every act was done by the power of the Holy Spirit. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. There was sin on him, but there was no sin in him. My sin was put on him, but not in him. That is an important distinction. Therefore, you and I are saved by being identified with him. He identified himself with us in baptism. And Peter says that we are saved by baptism. Again, this is another place where we make a distinction with other religious denominations. The verse is gravely misinterpreted and misunderstood. It is not baptism alone that saves us. It is by being identified with the Lord Jesus Christ that saves us. To be saved is to be in Christ. How do we get into Christ? When we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior and turn from our old ways, that point of true conversion, not just saying the words, but believing in the deepest parts of our heart, then the Holy Spirit comes to live inside of us immediately to help us. And that is the baptism that we are talking about. At that point, we have been joined together with Christ for all eternity. The Lord Jesus said, "Him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out." We must recognize that we have to be identified with Christ, and that is accomplished by the Holy Spirit. Our water baptism is a testimony to people around us and our loved ones that we have joined with Christ. This subject of baptism needs to be lifted out of the realm of argument to a high and lofty plane of standing for Christ. It is important for us to come out and stand for Christ. Let me repeat verse 15. And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he suffered him, that is, that John then baptized him. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." Can there be anything more wonderful than that? There are so many people around the world who would just love for their earthly father to put his hand on their head or shoulder and say, "This is my beloved child, who I am very proud of right here on earth." It doesn't happen very often. I can't tell you that one day the Lord is going to put his arm around every Christian and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." There are going to be a whole lot of Christians in heaven who have done nothing after being saved, who will be in heaven barely by the skin of their teeth, as my grandfather would say. But there will be many who will feel those arms as Jesus felt the pride of his Father as the heavens opened up to him. The dove flew out and a great voice filled the sky. "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And all the pain and agony from all the hard work and suffering done here on earth for our Lord will just simply melt away. And in that moment, it won't even be able to be remembered. Remember, people have done a lot for the Lord, and there have been people who have suffered greatly. But I know that in that moment, all of that will go away. Listen to what I just said. All the hard work and suffering done here on earth for our Lord. You see, this is another key. Most of us do way too much work for ourselves and way too little for our Lord. All that we have done for ourselves will disappear in an instant, like the snap of a finger. It will be gone. Only the work and suffering we have done for our Lord will be remembered. The Lord Jesus is now identified with his people. What a king. Oh, what a king he is. Our hymn of dedication this morning is "Just As I Am," because our great king takes us just as we are.
Just as I am. Come to
Jesus wants us to know that he did everything. That's why we can come to him just as we are. We don't have to make ourselves perfect. We don't have to do anything, but just recognize and realize that we need to be saved. Mike, will you please come forward? Will you please rise? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have given us. We thank you for our lives, and we thank you for our families. We thank you for our homes and all that we have, and all that we have that we take for granted. Watch over us. Be with us this week. Be with those who watch from home. Help us to be the people that we need to be. Keep your hand upon us. Guide us and lead us and draw us back to you. Help us to open our Bibles and read the gospel. Help us to reach out to someone this week, to invite them to Bible school, Sunday school, youth group. Keep your hand upon us and all that we have. Help us to tell somebody about Jesus this week. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen.